Welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for taking time out of this incredibly busy part of the year for a lot of people. I know some of you are from small delis and farm shops and cheesemongers. So brilliant to have you here. We're so excited to have as partners Invest Northern Ireland so that the Academy of Kit Cheese can showcase to our 3,000 students and alumni, nearly 3,000, 45 off, and our database of cheese lovers all around the world. People are studying with us in 70 different countries, so this really does take it global. So today is about celebrating our partnership with Invest NI, and about showcasing some amazing Northern Irish cheeses. We have some of them to try. We can only sincerely apologise for those of you that your hampers didn't arrive. The storms, you couldn't predict it, could you really? The last 2 weeks have been hell. This nearly finished me off yesterday. But the storms, the ferries were stopped from Belfast where the cheeses and all the products were coming from. So I did email all of my people to sincerely apologise. But for those of you that have got it, fantastic. Enjoy, nibble away. It's not compulsory to try them now. If you'd rather watch the recording back following this, no problem at all. We can, you know, we will send out the recording as well, because there's quite a lot of produce. If I drank all four of those beers, I'd be on the floor, so better not. So we've got Johnny from Indie Fude, who's going to be hosting today, and he is going to tell us, or he's going to introduce the producers to you who have joined us virtually as well. And I'm going to just show you a quick video of Johnny's place in Northern Ireland. It is the most amazing store, full of gorgeous produce. So I'm going to share my screen with you. If the video is a little bit clunky, we apologize. It is good quality, but it kind of depends on your bandwidth where you are as well. So bear with us. It will be on the video. Oh, look at that man, Drew, you're in your car. That's dedication. Dedication, love it. Love a Zoom in the car. We have a Russian training partner, and she did a Zoom with me to set up all of her account for the training in her car driving through Russia.
And yeah. I was very multitasking.
Are you sure you're allowed to do that? And she was like, oh, it's not busy. Absolutely. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
I had a good friend who's a professional coach, and that's what he does, mostly in the car around the whole of Europe and the world.
Amazing. I think you're stationary though, aren't you, Drew?
I am.
Good boy. I would like to say, though, if we're struggling with bandwidth, you can turn your videos off. If you want to ask questions, please use the chat or raise your hands and take your microphone off. All good. But Michelle's going to tell you about that as well. Right. I am going to share my screen with you so we can watch the video of Johnny, and then we're going to see him for real. He's already been eating his cheese.
Hello everyone, my name is Johnny McDowell from Indie Fude, based here in Cumber, in rainy County Down at the minute. Indie Fude's all about, by its name, indigenous produce and being independent. We love to showcase local. Most important, all our products come from around the island of Ireland, whether it's oils, jams, vinegars, balsamic, wonderful meats, and of course, fantastic cheeses. We love to showcase them both here, online through our store, in our cheese store as well, over in the Ormo Road, and also in our beautiful hampers at Christmas time. And we're really proud to support small batch. So we like to think that we have great relationships with all our producers from all around the island who love producing amazing produce, whether it's fantastic jams, chutneys, crackers that go with some of our fantastic cheeses, And also we have some delicious beef and pork products here in the store that some of the guys make into fantastic charcuterie as well. I believe we're going to try that later on also. So you have wonderful salamis and chorizo from Corndale Farm, even some venison salami. We have from Espini as well, we have lovely copa, and we've got lovely lomo in there too. And then of course the cheeses, which is all important to us here at Indie Fude. We're really proud of our cheese counters. I think we represent something like 40 different cheeses from around the island, and we're going to, I guess, taste and showcase some of those fantastic Northern Ireland cheeses specifically here this afternoon with you guys. And of course, pair them up lovely with some of those chutneys I talked about, some of the meats, and also some wonderful beers as well from Whitewater. So really looking forward to having you later on, and thank you very much for visiting Indie Fude.
So I'm going to hand over now to Michelle, who's from the business development team at InvestNI, who with her team has organised all of this for us. And I'd like to say thank you so much to Michelle and Shona, who have been absolutely brilliant in putting it all together. And I think you would all agree. So over to Michelle. She's going to just tell you a little bit about what's the schedule, and then we'll start the session.
Brilliant. Thanks, Tracy. Welcome, everyone. You all know Jen, Rosemary, Drew, Shauna on the call as well. I know we've all individually invited you along, depending on who we know. Great to have everyone together. First of all, apologies again for the, I think there are a few outstanding boxes, particularly in the southeast of England, but when you get your box, there are a couple of little Fortnum & Mason's products in there, and those have come from Graham's Bakery in Dromore, from Tim Graham, and he's put his business card in there if any of you would like to get in touch on those particular products. Lots of other goodies in there, and you'll see in your box a copy of our brand new cheese brochure, as well as a list of the products in your box with contact details if you want to follow up on any of those. And as Tracy said, as we go through the call, please feel free to post anything in the chat box, comments about the products, any little bits of chat, all welcome. So I'll hand over now to Johnny and let him crack on with some products. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Michelle. And thanks very much, Tracy, for the introduction earlier on. Like to say hello to everybody and welcome. I jumped out of the shop for the afternoon. You're pleased to hear it's still tipping it down, raining here in Northern Ireland. But I think after opening that box of goodies, it's really certainly brightened my mood for this afternoon, and hopefully yours as well. So I think we're going to run through this afternoon. We're going to meet our fabulous cheesemakers and also some of the other artisan producers that you find in your box. I must say the array of goods that came out and the quality of them just brought a great smile to my face. I think you just said on the clip, I've got a great passion for local produce, and I think hopefully you'll be able to sort of hear that and taste it this afternoon and find how good Northern Ireland cheese and food is in general, and hopefully hear a bit more of the stories and the passion of our fabulous producers as well at the same time. So first I'd like to kick off with talking to our first cheesemaker, that is Mark Wright of Ballylisk. Good afternoon, Mark. Mark, are you there?
Mark. Good afternoon, Johnny, and good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, Morgie, how are you? Good to see you.
Likewise, thank you. And I see, congratulations to Johnny here. He is 5 minutes ahead of his schedule, according to this email. In any event, personally speaking, and I'm sure everybody else feels the same way, I'm absolutely thrilled to have been asked and to be able to take part this afternoon. For those who don't know who we are, my own pop-up sitting behind us, our brand is Ballylisk of Armagh. Johnny spoke there about his passion for Indigenous food and even the company name. Just to give a wee bit of background about our own sort of recent journey, we spoke to Johnny. I first met Johnny in 2016, about this time of the year, in Lisburn. My brother and I started this business together, and we were teasing out some ideas. Met him in Lisburn store, selling his own cheeses, and actually have been looking for Young Buck, which is Mike's cheese, one of my favourites. Without going on about it, 2017 came, we worked through our R&D phase. Johnny was very supportive. We asked for advice, and he said, look, bring me samples and I'll try this here. What we do, we make a range of cow's milk semi-soft, white mold ripened cheeses. Our flagship cheese, the Triple Rose, is a triple cream. And when we first got that made, Johnny said, that's really good. I'd say that for you. And he has. And he has been very supportive to us. But things have moved on. Like any business, you'd expect it to grow a wee bit. As I say, that was our first cheese. Within a year of going into production, and I'm not trying to name drop, but just to give it a wee bit of context and provenance, we were listed with that cheese into Fortnum & Mason. And that was a really thrilling thing. And it was very easily carried from a PR point of view, etc. But we have continued to expand the range. And essentially now, with the cheeses come in different sizes, we also have a very refined smoked version of the triple cream cheese. We smoke with cherry wood, very refined, very light. The brief there was not to take away from the creamy paste, which is unashamedly luxurious. We also do a cider wurst version of it, which we do more seasonally. We have developed a very nice farmhouse brie, which took a wee bit of time, trial and error. We had different bries that were okay, but we now feel that our own brie is right up there, and I'm certainly very confident that it stands toe-to-toe with any of the top French bries or whatever. Our wee company, I say, has continued to expand, but for us, and when I say expand, we're still a small company, but for us, the real thrill here is being part of a group, and that really energizes you. When you look at Johnny's shop there, I think that is actually case in point. It's a very, very good illustration of what's going on the island of Ireland. You go in there and it's Aladdin's Cave, whatever kind of sort of specialty food you're looking for, the best of it is essentially sitting there on those shelves. So we're very proud to, you know, be part of that group. And the group is very strong. When you look at, I think there's a lot of, we're a small country, there's a lot of joined up stuff going on here. When you look at the likes of, you know, what Michelle is doing across on the mainland, Jen's doing sort of the Republic of Ireland, you know, those invest in AI guys, you have the AI people. There's a real movement here.
And Mark, I just want to focus in on the sizings then that your lovely cheeses come available. I know at Indie, yeah, we take them in all three different sizes. Do you want to talk us a bit through that as well?
Yeah, we have essentially catered as wide as we can with our sizing for, you know, to kind of something for all the different customers. We can do the sort of the 1 to 1.1 kilo wheels, big rounds, which some delis are looking for cutting. We do 130 gram size, which is very good for retail, and then the 230 gram essentially size is exceptionally good for food service. If you take that on cheese boards, you probably get 6 exact portions out of it. The sizes for the brie are slightly smaller, with a 200 gram and a 110 gram, both quite good for retail, and then the brie's cut really well, and some people like to buy it that way. Some shops like to sell it that way.
Mark, I think I know, obviously, us meeting back in 2016, and it's hard to believe how vastly you guys have grown, but I think the testament to it has been the quality of the cheese. And I know the customer base here, which I know well, the local customer base here in Northern Ireland, as I rove around with my traveling little cheese stall, even through our stores and some of my own other friends in the sort of the deli industry, the cheese is just so sought after. And I remember last Christmas, it was, you couldn't get a Ballylisk for love nor money. And Northern Ireland people are, as you know, they're very opinionated on everything. Never mind their food and their drink. They like to say what is. And Ballylisk, I must say, has just really, really hit the mark since it came on the market here. I think it was, you know, a great success story to see you and the family put so much effort into the local market, first of all, and then watching you grow to those export channels and do it so well as well. Do you want to talk us through some of where the places that you've been sending Ballylisk out to?
Yeah, well, I just want to say, actually, if you look at that brand, Ballylisk of Armagh, and again, come from County Armagh here, where the apples are grown, very lush pasture land, etc. But back to that sort of local story, we're really thrilled to be part of it. And the support you're getting does energize you. But right now, I mean, obviously, as I'm sure everyone's doing their business, we're looking forward to 2022. We're going out to Dubai in February to Gulf Food. I would like to be expanding my reach on the mainland. As I say, down south to Dublin, Galway, Cork, where we are well known in Dublin. Proud to say that it's the Triple Rose is on a lot of the cheese boards and a lot of the really good restaurants and hotels in Dublin. I introduced the smoked cheese at an event recently, and it went down very well. I met a lot of executive chefs, etc. But as I say, next year I'm trying to look further afield. We would really like to find or pair up with a distributor or distributors on the mainland, Greater London, further afield. I think it's the right time for us. We've worked very hard just to tell the group about what we have to offer, to protect the brand, place it. It has become, and you're very kind, Johnny, your words, it has become has become established in a certain way, and we're proud of that. But you can't sort of sit in your hands, so to speak, or your rest on your laurels. The brand, we felt the opportunity for the cheeses, or where the cheeses that we make sit, was at the top of the market, the specialty, the delis, etc., fine dining, all that sort of thing. We are not looking to put the Ballylisk brand into multiple retailers. I mean, I look at the likes of Ox Restaurant in Belfast, who again came in very quick. What Johnny's saying about supporting local, he's not the only person. I kind of pinch myself. I'm not trying to name drop, but when you hear, I don't know everywhere the cheese goes because we obviously sell some of the food service, but when you meet people at events and say, I love your cheese and I get it X, Y, and Z, you're really, really thrilled. When people come back to you now, and for our wee journey, especially going to events, people buying the cheese again, being really positive and kind about it, it's an amazing thing. I think you can sell anything once, but the real trick is people coming back to you.
Yeah, and that's certainly what we see, Mark, here in, you know, here in Northern Ireland. People keep coming back for it. And, you know, with regards to the Triple Rose, that real indulgent style of that triple cream cheese, people have really embraced. I know people love a cream tea here, for example, and love that. Some customers said to me, oh, you know, this is kind of like the clotted cream of the cheese world.
Well, when we first tried to cut across here, because I know time, and obviously time's coming up for me. When we first decided, or were making our decisions as to what type of cheese, and we did a lot of research, and we had a lot of conversations. You were one of the first one, but there were other people as well, and we got great help. I know Mike's coming in later on. Mike's a really good supporter as well. He's doing business, but which you should be exceptionally proud of. But he's been very supportive, as has Kevin. And, you know, this is a really, really good thing, and it really does help you. But the brief for that Triple Rose was, imagine you were listening to a podcast, or you had your eyes closed and someone was describing it to you. The reaction hopefully would be your mouth starting to sort of water a bit or whatever, and going, gosh, I want to eat a bit of this. So if I told you about it briefly and that's how you felt, I'd be thrilled. And I think hopefully that's what that cheese is about. Unashamedly luxurious, the buttery, creamy paste, the velvety aftertaste, and it's standing the test of time at this particular moment.
It is, and it's, I think for certainly us in the as a cheese shop and cheesemongers, it's so well positioned, even just here in the Irish market. Like, there was a lot of double cream sort of semi soft cheeses, mold ripened out on the market, brie styles, but use guys coming in and doing a triple cream, and then developing that and perfecting that recipe, and then moving on to the single rose, the single cream. And so some of the customers have, you know, converted from the triple cream now to the single cream. They like to try it sort of alternate times. But I think the single cream, having a lot of people say holidaying on the continent, especially, Mark, and sort of saying, oh, I want a really oozy, gooey brie. You've really nailed that brief and really captured those people's imagination from their time on holiday. Because there's, again, I suppose in Ireland, there's not really anything like that on the market, single rows.
And it's great because the shops that we, like yourself and a number of other places, these people know what they're at. They know how to explain it to their own customers and know it at its best. And as you say, when it starts to sort of go a bit softer, I mean, when it's at its best, super flavor, etc. What have we coming next? Perhaps is something that I want to talk about. I have them made. But I can't sell them this Christmas. I bought about £600 worth of truffles there about 2 months, six weeks, 2 months ago. And I have made a truffled version of the triple rose. That will be launched early in the new year, and it will be available next year. Not to everyone, I think, for this, less is more. It's right at the top of the kind of the taste pyramid. It'll be out for and will be available for Easter and Christmas next year. But I have made a number of samples and the feedback on that has been exceptionally good. I'm really excited about it and I'm simply whetting everybody's appetite. And what's this?
Can't wait for it, Mark. I know there's, again, being a, you know, a cheesemonger retailer here in Northern Ireland, a lot of people, again, have travelled and asked for a truffle brie. That's something, especially this time of year. So I think it'll be really well received. And it's also touching on your full suite, Mark. I know you mentioned there, you know, working closely with other producers in that wonderful Armagh area, which is known well for its apples, but not only the cheeses, but the wonderful, and I think you've done it so well. You've worked with some local producers making chutneys and crackers under your brand as well. So that suite of products, which I know we order off you, I think at that high end, luxurious end, they're fantastic. And yeah, it's a great offering to anybody anywhere in the UK.
Yes, we're very pleased. We have a small range, as you say. We have two chutneys and two fruit preserves. We have a spiced pear chutney. We have a balsamic Bramley apple chutney. We have a damson preserve and a blackcurrant and lime preserve. The two preserves have 30% less sugar than jams. You certainly wouldn't want a jammy, syrupy, sugary accompaniment to your cheese. For me, I'm not some sort of health crusader. This was about the fruit, but there is an obvious health benefit. We also, as part of our range of accompaniments, we sourced oatcakes from Ditty's up in Castle Dawson. And I would say those are the best biscuits we can buy. In that range, there are celery and sea salt. Yes, there they are. And Ditty's make us nice little square ones, but these are exceptional. We have celery and sea salt, apple, and again, there's a bit of local cider going into those apple oat cakes and a traditional one. And as I say, those are, and we also, when we're at events now, again, just as part of this movement where we are, we have a local honey producer, and I'd say he's making some of the best honey in Northern Ireland. It's a very nice fit if you want to go and bake the brie. Wee bit of honey and walnuts, whatever, if you're, you know, putting it in the baker there, it's something really, really to behold.
And Johnny, you know, when you're talking about drinks pairings, perhaps for some of these cheeses, shall we have a little look at what Kerry might have to offer us?
I'm very excited.
Hello, Kerry.
Unmute myself there because I had myself muted.
Hi, Kerry. How are you? Good to meet you.
I'm very well. Same to you, Johnny. Yep. And good. Hello, everybody in the virtual world.
What do you think? Which one of the beers in front of us today would you recommend? Do you think with Mark's lovely triple cream, triple rose brie?
Yeah, probably the Belfast Lager, I'd say. Though saying that, I always find with a lot of different things, personal choice. I wouldn't turn around and say, oh, it has to be the lager. I think, again, it's what you enjoy. And the best thing that you can do with any type of food is drink something that you enjoy. So if you are not a lager fan, there's nothing to say that you can't, you know, try one of the other beers along with it. But as I say, if we're going to go with sort of your matching, I would say we'd start with the Belfast Lager. So the Belfast Lager is 4.5. So there's so many different ones here, but 4.5% ABV. So it has Saz hops in it. So it's a very clean, crisp lager. Goes very well with soft cheese because the soft cheese is has a delicate flavor. Correct me if I'm wrong in that, but it has a delicate creamy flavor that you don't want to lose that flavor by drinking anything that's too overpowering with it, because you want the cheese to sing. Because obviously that is that, you know, if you want to accompany something, you want to accompany it and make the best out of both. So you don't want a too overpowering cheese with a lager, because then you'll lose the flavor of the lager, and vice versa. You don't want to lose that gorgeous flavor of the brie. So a lager goes lovely with that. So it's nice and crisp and clean. So it also cleans your palate as well. So Belfast Lager, I'd say it is. Yeah. Do we see it? Belfast Lager.
Great advice, Kerry. That is a delicious pairing, I must say. And I've got my little Diddy's Oat Cake with some of Mark's Ballylisk going on with that beer pairing. I think you've nailed it. Actually, I had a little bit of the Erin Grove Fig and Thyme chutney alongside as well, and that's not too bad either. That all works really, really deliciously. I'm going to move on. Thank you very much, Kerry, and again, Mark, really appreciate your time today. Good to see you, and I'm going to move on to our next cheese producer, who's miraculously sitting beside me, as he's virtually my next door neighbour here in East Belfast. Davide Tani. Davide is from he's representing today both Bello Cheese, his own cheese company, which has its roots in Sardinia, where Davide is from. But he's also at the moment the cheesemaker in situ at Kearney, one of Northern Ireland's oldest artisan cheeses, based just outside Belfast here in the beautiful Castlereagh Hills on Farmview Dairies. And the Kearney is the softest blue in front of you today. I'm just going to hold that up so you get the right one. And I'm going to introduce you to Davide, and he's going to tell you a little bit about the Kearney blue first of all. Good afternoon, Davide.
Hi, John. Hi, everyone. So, yes, Kearney blue and Bello cheese. In common, they have the milk. So I supply the milk from Farmview, and Richard asked me if I wish to continue to make Kearney blue, because Paul, who developed the recipe, wanted to go to retire it. And when I try a taste and read the history of the Kearney, I was quite pleased to continue this heritage. So I like very much this cheese because it reminds me a bit of Gorgonzola, that is mild and mellow compared with the Stilton, that has a nice sharp taste. And it was one of the first artisan cheese. It has several prizes, has been developed in the kitchen of Kearney Village. And only after 6 months, the challenge of Paul was to try to make a cheese in his kitchen. And he succeeded, he liked him, he liked the cheese. And then he wanted to check if it was something, because he made, or it was actually a quite nice cheese. So he sent, and he won the first time at the best Irish cheese in the British Awards in 2011, after 6 months. And that's after that, a lot of restaurants started calling him, said, can we order that? And he was a bit too unprepared of that success. And they built a new company with Farmview that was supplying from the beginning the cheese. And that's it. That's his history. He has other more awards, bronze, the best Irish cheese in the World Cheese Awards, and so.
And he's also got, I believe, he's got a 3-star Great Taste Award in 2017. Again, the only Northern Ireland cheese to hold that accolade. Paul, I think, knowing Paul, and he's obviously looking towards retirement at the minute, hence Davide has been in sort of in that transition period in Kearney, bringing the cheese on. And I must, like, so hats off to Davide for continuing the excellence of Kearney. Since I, you know, first tasted it all those years ago, it's, you know, tasting as good as ever. I have to say, it's, you know, that delicious creaminess, that sort of slight spice. It's a very unique type of blue, I think. And knowing Paul, Paul and his background and his travels around Europe, he's an absolute food maestro. Absolutely, you know, if you ever meet a foodie who knows about cooking and recipes and any ideas, that's Paul McLean, the man behind Kearney Blue. And I think it's really come through in this sort of unique cheese that he wanted to produce. And yeah, as Davide said, Northern Ireland's oldest technically artisan cheese, you know, going that sort of 14, 15 years now. And it's a, you know, a testament of time. It's on, as Davide said, some of the finest menus in Northern Ireland and will continue to be there. But to me, it's a hidden gem. And so anybody, you know, across the UK, we've got obviously great access to markets here in Northern Ireland to send cheese over the water. There's no restrictions, no nothing like that. And so if anybody, yeah, wants to find, I suppose, a little hidden gem out there, I think Kearney Blue should be sort of top of your list. And fingers crossed, you know, Davide keeps producing such wonderful cheese. But I suppose now, just to sort of round off from where Kearney was, I'd like to ask Kerry if you could maybe recommend maybe one of the white water beers that goes maybe nicely with that lovely blue cheese.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, we have in front of you, I think you should have your selection of beers. We actually have two that probably would go very well. So I'd start with one, which is the Hopplehammer. So the Hopplehammer 6% triple hopped IPA. Now, this has got Chinook and Cluster hops in it, giving a good punch, a robust fruit flavor coming off this. So it goes very well with spicy cheeses and blues, especially very good. So it's quite a robust, strong fruit flavor. So it takes those stronger flavors that come from the blues and a spiced cheese. So yeah, the other one, which would go equally as well, which you have in front of you, is the U Rebel. 7%. So we're getting up the strength of the beer. So we're really hitting a punch with the alcohol in here as well, which you will get the headiness of that, yes. Thank you very much, Johnny. So the U Rebel has Mosaic, which has grapefruit and tanginess, it's very citrus flavors. So obviously, again, when you're having cheese, you know, the fruit and cheese go very well together and stuff. So yeah, you're gonna get the tanginess, the grapefruit cutting through, cutting through the cheese as well and that. So those are the two ones that I would recommend to have a go with.
Fantastic, Kerry. Yeah, both taste absolutely gorgeous. And that with that lovely sort of creamy, bluey, kearney, spicy kearney at the moment, it's a fantastic pairing. Thank you. Yep. And then just back to Davide. Davide is going to tell you a little bit about, you know, I guess where he came from in Italy and his cheese journey into what was Velo cheese, and give you a little insight, I suppose, to what he and myself are up to in Northern Ireland in the cheese production lines at the moment. So over to you, Davide.
Thanks, Mark. And yes, Velo cheese. Let's start with the name. Velo in French means bicycle. And this is because my Velo cheese is based in three main pillars that are my three passions. I've got a degree in electronic engineering, so technology is very important for me. Bicycles, I like bicycles but as a whole different view, not only as a transportation vehicle, but also a way to travel the world, and also has a important as a piece of machinery that has is beautiful. And the third one is, of course, food. As you know, Italy is food is I believe in any harvest. And I was lucky enough that my extended family was still farming. So my upbringing was during the summertime, go to pick tomatoes to make the tomato case for all here, peaches to make jam, pick olives to make olive oil, and I also press with my feet grapes to make wine. So that is, and cheese. So in Sardinia, there are more sheep than human beings. So cheese is very important. When I was six, I went with my father to buy some mozzarella in the cheese factory. And I always been quite curious. I went in the back doors where they were the laboratory making cheese. And for the first time, I ate the mozzarella was still warm. And that was a new universe. When I moved to Northern Ireland, I was very impressed with the quality of the milk. Also all the rest, but specifically the milk. And it was a bit tricky to come back to Italy. So I started to be craving fresh mozzarella. And that's started to merge all together. And I wish to show that it's possible to have a successful public business with being still neutral carbon footprint. This journey started 7 years ago, and 2 years ago I met Johnny when, thanks for common friends, and I was starting to sell cheese in the markets, and Johnny was looking for someone to sell the cheese in his stall markets, and that's why I started our business relationship that it went well, luckily, and we are continuing. And now we merge our strength and we made a new company. It's called Vero Cheese Times Indie Fude. And we are actually now building the new laboratory in a bigger project in East Belfast that is site in Banana Block. It's a living museum and we are going to make cheese there in so the people where there will be a big windows, you can see us making cheese and can buy cheese. And then there will be cheese classes, how to cook with cheese, because especially mozzarella, the people eat only cold, while it's one of the most versatile cheese. And our strong point that because all mozzarella came is imported, and there is a massive difference between chilled cheese and fresh cheese. Our cheese will be always 5 days fresher than any other mozzarella.
Thanks, Davide. And yeah, it's very exciting, obviously, for myself at Indie Fude. It's sort of part of our journey as we've come along from that little cheese stall that was kind of passed over to me by my good friend Mike Thompson, who will hear from later, and where I met Mark Wright for the first time, and also meeting Davide. So it's amazing where that little cheese stall has went then into a deli, and then ultimately meeting Davide, who's become a neighbor and a good friend. And again, I was just blown away by his skill set and bringing something different to the market here in Northern Ireland. And hearing Davide, you know, speak about his appreciation for the milk that we have here and the quality of the pasture and the dairy coming out of it. And to see that little bit of foreign influence and foreign passion for food coming back over to Northern Ireland and developing that raw material into something so fantastic is mozzarella, burrata, scorza, ricotta. He makes us fabulous cannolis and all sorts of things. It's endless. And he's really on the, again, and it sort of typifies a little bit here in Northern Ireland about that education piece. So when Davide is out on the market stall or I'm out there in the shop with the customers, you're talking about, you know, you're giving that backstory and educating the customers and talking recipes and talking how you use the produce, even to the chef level. I know Davide has worked, there's sort of a very vibrant street food market here and pizzerias and different things, and developing particular types of mozzarellas for those industries as well. So I think that's going to be what Indie and Velo are going to, that Indie Velo movement is going to be about. It's going to be listening to the market and developing cheeses for that market, but keeping that wonderful heritage that Davide has in Italy, but also, you know, appreciating that great milk that's available to us here in Northern Ireland.
It is very, very exciting news. I love, especially for us at the Academy of Cheese, to hear that you're bringing that educational element forward with the glass screen so that people can actually see. The whole point is people appreciating how that milk becomes this amazing product. We've got someone asked, Sharon has asked, what's the name of the new company, please? It sounds great.
It's Velo Cheese by Indie Fude. Very simply names, the two companies coming together. And Davide is, you know, an even part of our distribution model. Again, we're sort of realistic. We're looking at the local market, specifically around the Belfast area where we're going to be based. And you'll see Davide and myself pedaling around in these little banana bikes. Again, we don't want to use cars. We don't want to use vans. There's going to be trailers in the back of these free pedaling banana bikes, and that's how we're going to deliver the cheese to the sort of the cafes and the restaurants in Italy. So it's, again, it plays into banana block and the sustainability model where we're going to grow that side of the cheese business. So yeah, I think
I don't know where you get the time to do it all and cycle and deliver the cheese as well.
Yes, about that. So this project is now in his seventh years, and you can take data from TomTom, and virtually this average speed in Belfast is about 23 miles per hour. And Belfast has the very good position that is flat, virtually flat. It has a river, and so there are at least two main cycle lanes. And this, our vehicle is called Velomobile, that is like a cocoon with wheels. It's the most performance vehicle that has also the high speed record for human power, about 81 miles per hour. But this is for me, from my engineering point of view, is the future, fundamentally. I believe that if we want to go away from the cars, the electric cars is just the first step, but we have to disconnect with the cars, because my example is using the car that is 2,000 kilograms heavy to move 80 kilograms of flesh is unsustainable. We want to be a showcase how to transport in our most performance way our product.
So human power.
Yes, the forgotten energy.
Can I just ask another question? Sorry, is coming from me. So in terms of Kearney Blue, what's the future then? So are you looking for a new cheesemaker to make it, or are you going to carry on making it, or what's the score, or is that not an answerable question?
About the Kearney Blue, it will stay as it is, because I think it's perfect. It's nice and has a history, and I wish to don't lose the fact that it's the first cheese. In the new lab, we won't make only mozzarella. We, being a living museum, we will show anything you can make with milk, and also all the bioproducts like whey.
But you will continue with the production with Kearney Blue?
Yes, absolutely. Okay. I will work in two different labs, because normally when you produce Kearney Blue, because there is involved mold,
you need to be
any
separate.
Other cheese. So you must have two distinct places to avoid cross-contamination.
And a thing for us, Tracy, you know, having Richard up at Farm View Dairies as a, you know, a great supporter of what we're trying, what David and I are trying to do.
Okay.
And we obviously have a bit of a settling in time in the new laboratory. So Richard's support to date has been fantastic, and he's going to, you know, he's let us sort of test and do different things up at Farm View and his own distribution channels. He's going to help through as well. So just that relationship between Indie, Davide, and Farm View will continue for the
near future.
The current future. Yeah.
That's
so
good. I'm being told by Michelle we need to move on. To the next lovely supplier in the nicest possible way.
I think I've been like going back to beer again, and I was going to ask Kerry a little just I know we've had two or three of our wonderful beers to date, but just to give us the background on Whitewater, the beers we had in front of it. I know it's like over two decades old, Kerry, and just to sort of fill us in on that.
Yes, yeah, thanks, Johnny. Yeah, just a bit of background on Whitewater and how we came about. So myself and my hubby Bernard, we started back in 1996, so quite a few years ago now. And we started on the family farm. So it was the fifth generation family farm set right up in the heart of the Mourne Mountains. And we started there producing very simply cask conditioned beer at the start. And then as the years have gone on, we have slowly grown and developed and introduced new styles of beer. So we probably have in production around 15 different varieties of beer that we produce, everywhere from the lagers, the Belfast lager, which you tried, a Helles style lager, which is a German style lager, right through from your red ales into your IPAs and your stouts. So quite a wide range of products that we produce. So we actually have on site now, we've invested over the years in a lot of equipment, along with Invest NI's help. We have installed our own bottling line, so we bottle our products on site. We have our own canning line now, so we actually can can our products as well, which again, moving forward for different markets, the sustainability of glass versus the you know, the aluminium cans, there's a balancing act between, you know, the recycling and the weight in aluminium as well for transport. So we've invested in that. So we on site, we do everything ourselves. So we can, we bottle, we keg, we cask. So we're everything in house. And then if you can see behind me, so we are so proud of achieving the award that we did for the Golden Fork, because Northern Ireland itself has the most amazing produce across all aspects of produce. I think we can truly sing very high in the quality of our produce here. So,
Jerry, you've got a little question there, just asking whereabouts in the UK can people get hold of your beers?
Well, we have a distributor that sells into sort of the London area, but outside of that, we don't have a great deal of foot on the ground. We are predominantly here in Northern Ireland. And then we actually export further afield. For us, we find that because we're in Northern Ireland and that stretch of water between ourselves and England, produce getting transferred across means that competing with the beers that are produced in their own local breweries within the UK and England, we find it hard to compete on the price for that. So we have found over the years that we have grow on our business here, and then we also we export to, you know, in foreign exports. We would absolutely love to be able to get in to the mainland UK market. But again, it is a lot to do with the local beers that are produced there and then competing against that. But if there's anybody out there that would like to like to bring us in, we would love to.
Get in touch. And there's another, and are you in the Cork area at all? There's a question there for you.
Not as far as Cork yet, no. we're down in Dublin. We've managed to get down that far, but not down quite as far as Cork yet.
Lots of new potential for you on the coal.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but we'd love to get out as far as and reach out and get people to try our product as far as we can. But we're here, we're homegrown, and we're spread quite across Northern Ireland now. We're doing okay and getting our foot across the doorsteps in Northern Ireland, which is good.
No, it's great to have the pairings today as well with those local cheeses. Johnny, I see that we've got Brendan from Killowen who's just joined. I wonder if we should move on to what rum we can have with our cheese.
Oh, even better. Yeah, need a wee bit of rum to go with something. Hiya, Brendan, you all right?
How you doing, Johnny? Good to see you, buddy.
Yeah, good to see you again. How's the form?
Hi, not too bad. Not too bad.
Want to tell us a wee bit about your rum?
Yeah, just, do you know what? This rum doesn't exist right now. It's all sold out. We're looking forward to bringing some more out in the new year. So it's working its way through a Solera system in the distillery. But yeah, so we had the same problem last night. There was a few bottles left in Stewartstown in a tasting. And the guys absolutely loved it. So I think there's one or two up there left now. So a bit of a drive if anybody wants some. But we're the lucky few at the moment, I suppose, so we can get to taste it.
I can see Aoife smiling. She looks as if she might be ready to try it.
That's great. But it's great to go on after. With a lot of respect for what the guys up in Whitewater there are doing as well. So they used to just be over the hill from us, and now they're up in Castle Island now as well. So fair play to Kerry. It was really great listening to you there.
Brendan, how are you?
Good on you.
Brilliant. Thank you.
What are you going to pair it with, Johnny?
Hello?
What are you going to pair it with, Johnny?
Oh, the rum. I'm just going to drink that neat, I think. it's just so good on its own. I think if you're going to say cheese-wise, I'm probably looking at Dart Mountain.
I think Dart Mountain. Or either
the lovely Banneker Bold, which is their ale-washed Alpine-style cheese. I don't know, do we have Kevin or Julie on the line? From Dart Mountain?
Oh, yes, hi.
Julie, how are you? You all right?
Hello, how are you? Good.
Yeah, good. Banneker Bold today?
Banneker Bold, good, yes. I'm a little ashamed after hearing all your cycling exploits, but we're here in the middle of the Sparren Mountains, and I think if I had to cycle my cheese around, it would finish me off. But fair play to you, and good luck with the new venture.
Thanks very much. Julie, do you want to give us a bit of background on Dart Mountain Cheese?
What you and Kevin have
set up there?
Yeah, I'm one half along with my husband, Kevin. We're in Park Village, which is about 17 miles outside of Derry. We make a range of cheeses. I've got 8 now. We've started with our Sparren Blue and then went on to Dart Mountain Dusk, which is an ash-coated cheese, and then the Banneker Bold, and then the Kilcrean came. Kevin keeps saying I've got to stop with the cheese variations, but when you're in there, you know, the possibilities are endless. So it's just been an interesting journey, and I'm just fascinated by the alchemy of the cheese making process. So, and we now have, we just started working with 2 young guys who approached us. They were sheep farmers, and they said they were going to get goats, and if they did so, would we take their milk? And we have done there about 3 miles down the road from us, Craig Van Goat Farm. And so now I'm making Carrick Vaughan, which is a soft, creamy, fresh cheese, which you can age on, and it develops a nice wrinkly rind and a good cream line. And Meany Hill Goat, nice, hard, salty cheese. And Meany Hill Blue, which is a goat.
Yeah, I know you introduced about this time last year, Julie, the Meany Hill to us down in Indie Fude. And yeah. Fabulous cheese. So congratulations on that. It's absolutely
well, thank you, sir. Thank you for having me.
you picked up quite a few awards over the years.
Yeah, we got the Dart Mountain got a bronze at the World Cheese Awards, and the Banher Bold got a gold at the World Cheese Awards. The Spare and Blue gold at Los Naharan, and a handful of other ones. So it's been good. We've taken a little time out from the awards just with the pandemic and just with focusing on developing the new range of goat cheeses. But hopefully we'll get back at it in the new year.
And again, I think you have found a great place in the market, sort of with those sort of the alpine-y style, the fruity, nutty types of cheeses, whereby, you know, we've already talked with sort of Ballyliscuit finding that as well, even Davide on the Italian side, but it also applies to yourself and Kevin, what you are doing there. And, you know, they're beautifully packaged, even the pre-packs, I know, just fly off our shelves. They're wonderful for the shops, the hampers, for the delis, any of the retailers. They have a great look, and again, they've got a very loyal customer base as well. They keep coming back.
We've embraced the localness, and we're small enough that we can kind of adapt. You know, we do catering sizes, full wheels, a lot of smaller hamper pieces, so we can adapt to what the customer wants, and that's worked well for us over the last 10 years or so.
And again, I know yourselves, you've developed sort of a lovely chutney range and oat cakes as well, which, you know, complement your cheeses deliciously too.
Yeah, we do the chutneys, we do a nice farmhouse chutney, which started out because there were courgettes out there and I couldn't figure out what to do with them. So they got jarred up, and then it kind of took off from there. I do a beetroot pickle, a sweet onion, then we've just introduced in the last couple of years, you know, there's so many, you know, as we see talking to people today, there's so many great breweries around. So we thought, what can we do with those? Another way to get beer into all meals of the day. And I developed a range of beer jellies, beer drizzles, you know, instead of, say, putting a honey over your hard cheeses, just a little drizzle of this beer-based condiment, I guess. And we work with the Banher Bold is washed in the number 26 Irish Pale Ale made by Martina and David Rogers over in Campsie, not too far from us. And now we make a beer jelly from their Kolsch style beer. Heaney Farmhouse Brewery down in Balaki, down in the south of the county, I use one of their beers, and Longmeadow Ciders, Armagh Cider, to make a nice Armagh cider jelly that goes really, really beautifully with both the blue, the Spare and Blue, and the goat cheese range. So,
brilliant innovation, Julie. And, you know, just again, using those that other local produce just shows you your passion for what's on your doorstep and what you can use, and things that actually, you know, highlight and enhance your cheese, not just there for the sake of it. And I know, again, from my own personal point of view, they go wonderfully, and the customers, I know, love them too. And the sizes and the shapes and the design are spot on as well. So congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good to talk.
Thank you for helping us on our way.
I've just got a question there, Johnny. Keith is just in heaven now at the thought of beer jelly. Keith is BBC Good Food magazine editor, and he does love beer. I can, you were with him at the World Cheese Awards, so you know. But he's also asking, what's behind the name Dart Mountain?
Oh, Dart Mountain, there's the, I don't know, can you see, that's kind of the, I don't know if you can see the, that's.
I need to get him some of that for Christmas.
Yep, well, we'll hook us up, and we'll get it on its way. Dart Mountain, if we had any daylight here, and I was able to stretch this computer cord, I could show you Dart Mountain, which is the mountain right behind us, where I make the cheese here. So okay. As I say, and all the cheeses, we've taken the local names, you know, from all the various townlands. The goat cheeses are made. The goats are on Menai Mountain, so Meany Hill were the choice name for the goat cheeses, and Carrick Vaughan, obviously, because of the white of the goat's cheese, the goat curd, White Rock. Kilcreen is the townland next to us. Dart Mountain, we're in the Sparren, so our Sparren Blue takes its name from that. So yeah, we've just taken, you know, there's an abundance of great sort of local names and local stories around here that we can use to enhance the appeal of the cheeses.
Fantastic. It's a great story. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Brilliant, Julie. Thank you. And I think we're on to the next cheese producer, good friend, Mike Thompson. Mike, you about?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Where are you coming from today?
I'm in the shop. We're in the middle of splitting the shop into two again for Christmas chaos, like. So I was up in Ards making this morning, and then ran down the shop to see your lovely wee face and talk about cheese, like, you know.
Thank you.
I always feel like after everyone else, everyone's got like 10 different cheeses and stuff like that. Our talk's a lot quicker because we just make one cheese, even though it feels like about 10 different cheeses if you ever try it, because it changes that much. But yeah, that's the joy of raw milk cheese making, I suppose, like, you know. So
give us a bit of background about Young Buck, Mike. When did you get started?
For sure, yeah. So I got to be making cheese now back in Northern Ireland for 8 years. Our 8-year cheese making anniversary there. About a week and a half ago. So again, it's mad that it's 8 years. It still feels like we're trying to figure out what we're doing. Again, sort of accidental cheesemaker. I'd spent a couple of years over in England working for a few different cheesemakers. I'm at the School of Artisan Food, did a course there, and then again met a lot of other sort of cheesemakers, guys like David Giant, who makes Roll Right and stuff like that, and also met Andy Swinsko, who's got the Courtyard Dairy. And I sort of blame Andy for everything. So again, whenever we were starting, we were deciding what type of cheese that we were going to make whenever we moved back. And Andy again sort of said, if you make a raw milk blue, it was something that we didn't have a lot of in the UK. And there wasn't much in Ireland. So that's kind of why we went that. Whenever we were starting, I had no money. I had no idea what I was doing. So we couldn't, make a cheese that was aged for longer than sort of 3 months. And again, because it was like the Northern Ireland cheese market at that stage, there wasn't even many farmers markets and stuff like that. So we didn't want to make something super fresh. So we were looking, making something in around that 3 months make. I'd spent a bit of time with Joe Schneider at Stitchelton, and it was just the most enjoyable cheese making experience I had. I sort of worked for the Clark's Spark and Hoe for a year, and I did a lot of work placement around different other cheesemakers all over the UK and stuff like that. Again, everyone's very opening and welcoming whenever you're wanting to start cheese making. So I just watched a lot of people's molds for a couple of years. So along the way, that was the kind of cheese that we enjoyed making the most. And that's sort of why we started making Young Buck. So it's a raw milk blue cheese. Probably the hardest thing for us, again, not coming from any sort of farming background, was getting the milk supply. We make a raw milk cheese. So again, that's probably one of the most important things that we needed to sort out whenever we were starting. And that's the great thing about Northern Ireland. And where we are, we're like Newton Ard, just about half an hour outside Belfast, just east of Belfast, top of Strangford Lock, and down that sort of Ard Peninsula, like Kearney was sort of started down at the very bottom of it. And there's just a mad selection of small dairy farms the whole way along there. So that's kind of was why we landed there. I was close to Belfast. And then we found a farmer after about sort of 4 or 5 months of sort of using different people's milk, and we've been with him pretty much ever since. It's been an enjoyable experience. And then we opened the shop here
No, I was going to say, Mike, it's just a real testament to yourself. Again, it's our number one selling cheese in Indie Food, and everywhere you travel around, even with the little cheese stall that you passed on to me all those years ago.
Cheese Fridays.
Cheese Fridays, yeah, that's right. And again, it just sums up Mike's such a great supporter of other people around him, whether you're making cheese or you're selling his cheese. Mike's that type of guy. And it really comes through in the quality of his product. That I know anybody that tries Young Buck, and you hear mentioned, especially when I was over at the World Cheese Awards doing the judging, it's the, whenever you say you're from Northern Ireland, one of the first things they'll talk about is the Young Buck blue cheese. And I guess they're just very lucky if they can get hold of it, because I know the demand is so high, and I'm not surprised by that. It's a fantastic story, and I know we're really proud to have Mike as one of our producers and on our doorstep, and proud of his heritage and where he comes from as well. And really comes through in his cheese. Fabulous.
We had some last night in the wine rack up in Sherstown as well. So Young Buck was definitely in the middle of everybody's cheese board. It's absolutely beautiful. So, yeah.
It's some spot down there, Alex. Very nice.
Tasting fantastic, Mike. It really is. It's just beautiful.
Yeah. Nice. Well, that's it. Again, like, if you could spread out your cheese eating across the year, it'd be delightful because, again, we sort of go mad making the cheese in the summer and then go mad selling it winter. So I need to find a wee couple of months to have nothing to do, like. So
if you could Mike, spread we're out working on that. We're working on it at the Academy. We're trying to get people to buy it all year round.
Exactly. Get a nice little midsummer holiday that we can sit and eat a ton of cheese and then, yeah, we're good.
That's brilliant. Thanks very much, Mike. And then just to cut back into Kerry, a little pairing with the Young Buck, perhaps that lovely stout. I know stout does go lovely with Young Buck in the past. I've had it. And what do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. The Belfast Black, which is our stout. So it goes beautifully with that. Yeah, the Young Buck would be absolutely stunning with that. It's the creaminess. So you have in the stout, you have gentle coffee flavors, chocolate flavors. The creaminess that you get from a stout just pairs beautifully with the creaminess that you'll have in the cheese. So 4.2% stout, gorgeous. The one thing I want to say about all these products is if you're going to have your beer along with your cheese, it's the same as when you're having the cheese. You don't want your cheese served cold. You want that cheese to be out of the fridge and at room temperature and nice and warmed up. The beer, obviously, you don't want to maybe possibly drink your beer warm, but not freezing cold out of the fridge, because you're going to lose a lot of those flavors that was masked by the chillness. So get your beers out so that they're not freezing cold, but yeah, it's just so that they have those full flavors can come through and you can marry those with your cheeses.
It's a really good tip, Kerry. I think it's definitely when you're, you know, whether you're serving cheese or beer, but also what I was just nibbling on there was the charcuterie, this wonderful free range charcuterie from Alistair. And again, I have it nicely sort of warmed at room temperature. It's hitting your mouth and that lovely taste and fat content just sort of blends in. So I'll probably pass over to Al. How are you, Al?
Hi, Johnny. Good to see you, mate.
Yeah, good to see you. Do you want to give us a wee bit of background in Corndale?
Hi, everybody. Yeah, I'm Alistair Crown from Corndale Farm in Northern Ireland. We are based in Lima Valley up in the northwest on the Causeway Coast and Glens. And to give you kind of a real background of where we come from, we started the farm as such back in 2012. No previous farming background or knowledge for that matter either. And I just had this real urge to kind of rear our own pigs. So I talked my dad in to let me buy four pigs, and me and him set off one day in the back of, or bought four pigs and put them in the back of his car, and brought them home and reared them in his vegetable garden. And that is literally where Corndale started. We completely fell in love with keeping pigs, and we kind of saw different aspects of where we could go with it. We started kind of slowly developing the farm and growing the farm. So from them four pigs, that developed into, you know, 4 or 5 years later, you know, a couple hundred pigs. We took on ground, we invested in machinery, we invested in sheds and equipment and arcs, and really kind of focused on the farm end of things. And then kind of 2015, we realized with all this pig meat and, you know, this great quality stuff, all we were doing was really kind of selling it to family and friends. So we spotted a gap in the market in Northern Ireland for charcuterie, especially locally made stuff. And I had this conversation with my wife that, you know, nobody's making chorizo in Northern Ireland. It was a product that we loved and we always bought every week. And Sarah, my wife, said, well, there's probably a good reason for that there's nobody making it in Northern Ireland. And I said, well, you know what, let's give it a go. And it worked for us. So to develop on that, we started with the one product that was our chorizo. And then we developed a full range of charcuterie products, including whole muscle products and soft spreadable products as well. So in front of you there today, you have our mixed charcuterie platter. It's probably one of our best-selling products, especially at this time of the year. It's a no-brainer for a cheese board. You need a wee bit of charcuterie on the side. And what we've done with these charcuterie packs, we've included kind of our best-selling products. So we've got our chorizo original, our picante one in there. And then we have our fennel salami. And then we have our smoked paprika lomo on there as well. So it gives you a nice selection of products that kind of accompany a cheese board really well. Where we are as a company, we kind of went full tilt at the charcuterie kind of 2016, 2017. And we started, you know, on a really small scale. A lot of the charcuterie equipment and the maturing rooms and fermentation cabinets, you know, they're really expensive. So, you know, we did this on our own back and we worked really hard to kind of build it up. But we were totally focused on the Northern Ireland market to start with. The past 2 years, we have grown the business kind of quite intensely, and we've now started to dip our toe into other markets. So we're down into the south of Ireland. We're trying to put stuff into GB as well. We've just, as of kind of 2 months ago, moved to a new facility. So we've kind of expanded our capacity by 4 or 5 times. We've really kind of put the bullet in terms of going forward with Corndale, and we want to get our product out, both into food service, but really into retail, and get it into the hands of people for them to enjoy. One good thing about our products, they're all ambient. They don't need refrigerated. And they all have a minimum 3 month shelf life on them as well. In terms of awards, you know, they've won loads of awards, Great Taste Awards, gold 2-3 years in a row at Blast na Héireann, gold in the British Charcuterie Awards. And they all have a nice shelf presence as well. So this time last year, we rebranded our products. Rebranded just to give our brand, Corndale Farm, a little bit of freshen up. And then we have our retail products as well. So we have the likes of the chorizo, the fennel salami, all in the wee rolls rather than the larger caliber stuff. And we have our venison salami as well. These are all available in retail packs. And then this would be our most recent product, which is our Indouya, which is soft, spreadable salami. Really trendy at the minute. It's for all the, you know, the home pizza cooks. Everybody's making pizzas in their backyard these days. Everybody wants Indouya. And as for next year, you know, we're really going to focus on our export side of the business. We really want to be getting into delis, farm shops, high-end retailers in GB in the south. And we've got a couple of really exciting products and a new product range for next year as well.
Great to hear, Al, and some wonderful comments just in the chat box. Some people who have both tried it here and tried it in the past. And again, being a deli owner here, I know in Northern Ireland, we, you know, we love your products. The customers love the products. Love the look of them, and the packaging is fantastic as well. And that ability to have them sort of ambient and the 3 month shelf life, I know, is a big plus as well. So well done on those.
The packaging, you know, it was a result of, you know, the likes of yourself, Johnny. You're, you know, one of our best customers and biggest customers, and we listened to the likes of yourselves and Laura and to other retailers, and how we could improve our packaging and what would help the product sell. And we listened, we took that on board, and I think we nailed it with the packaging. It's really helped.
Brilliant. Great range, Alan. Many continued success. Just moving, I suppose we're getting very near the end now, and I just want to welcome, I guess, it looks like our last guest on the cheese side especially. It's Sharon from Deal Farm. Hiya, Sharon.
Hello, how are you?
I'm good. How's yourself? Keeping well?
I'm very good. Very good. Yeah.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about the lovely chat you have in front of you and a bit more about the company?
Look, I guess, I mean, I've listened to all these lovely, lovely stories, and I can't help but think that of the more you as more artisan producers are probably thinking, what's a big company like Dale Farm on here talking about? And you know, particularly as the cheese that I wanted to talk about today, you know, it's not a small batch cheese, and it's not so artisanal. Some of those gorgeous cheeses, which I love, that you've all talked about today. But hopefully in going through this and talking a little bit about our cheese, I'm hoping some of you might be a wee bit surprised by some of the stuff that you hear. First of all, maybe a little bit about Dale Farm and me. I look after marketing for the Dale Farm portfolio, so please no technical questions about how I make the cheese or anything like that, because I'll have to get back to you on all of that if they come my way. But Dale Farm is a big business in Northern Ireland, and we are a dairy cooperative. And so we're made up of 1,300 dairy farmers. And that cooperative, I mean, we're owned by dairy farmers. That's essentially what it's about. And that cooperative, that is all centered around helping sustain family dairy farms for generations. And a lot of our farmers, you know, you're talking fourth, fifth generation of dairy farmers. And those are the guys who supply us with our milk. And it's that milk which is all Red Tractor approved. So every drop we can trace, every drop is safe, and it's farmed with the utmost of care. And that's the milk that goes into making all of our products, our milk, our creams, et cetera, et cetera. And also goes into making Dromona cheese. So Dromona cheese is what I want to talk about today. And when I started listening to you guys today on the call, I was thinking, oh my God, I feel like a bit of an imposter. You know, I feel a bit like Dromona is a wee bit of an imposter because, you know, as I said, we're not small batch cheese producers, and we're not artisanal in the purest sense. And then I had to stop myself and say, sort of like, hang on a minute. You know, there's a story to tell on the Dromona brand. And essentially that is that, you know, it's as local as it gets. So, you know, you can be big-er and you can be local. And I guess that's the message that I wanted to get across today and wanted to share with everyone today. You know, the provenance of the brand is something that's absolutely front and center for me. And as a marketing individual, that is something that I'm very much on a mission to communicate to everyday shoppers who buy cheese in the supermarkets in Northern Ireland, that when they buy Dromona cheese, they are buying a truly locally produced cheese from farm to fork. So what makes Dromona special, as a local cheese, is it's always made with local milk from Northern Ireland, from that farmer-owned cooperative. We supply the feed to those farmers, and it's all very nutritionally balanced. The cows are grass-fed. We have very strong, very high standards in terms of the quality of the milk. We pick the milk up, we collect the milk from the farms, and we take it to our Centre of Cheese Making Excellence, which is in just outside of Cookstown, which is where I'm from, in County Tyrone. And Dromona is only ever made in Northern Ireland. You know, you were talking a bit earlier there about the salamis and the packaging and about bringing the storytelling to life. I recently, a project of mine was to basically update our packaging so that we were telling the story of what made Dromona particularly special from a Northern Ireland context. And that would be made with local milk, naturally matured, So we don't add lots of nasties to speed up the maturation process, even though we're not a small batch cheese. We don't rush it. And we only ever make that cheese, our cheese, in Dunman Bridge, outside Cookstown in County Tyrone. And it's my mission to bring that message to local shoppers in Northern Ireland. It's an interesting one for me because working for a business like Dale Farm, you know, when I first started to say, you know, we've got a lot of untold stories about our Dromona cheese and indeed our Dromona butter as well. A lot of the suits, for want of a better term, in the business would have said, but sure, everybody knows that. Well, everybody didn't know that. Very few people really appreciated what makes Dromona local, so local, and so indigenous to this market. So I guess that from my perspective is where, as I say, I started off listening to all of these fabulous stories thinking, my goodness, I can't tell stories as rich as that, but Dromona definitely is a rich, it's a richly, I guess, embedded brand in Northern Ireland, and can proudly say that it is only ever made here. And to me, that's a nice compliment to what you smaller batch producers are doing as well. Because yes, we do supply into the multiples and to the higher, the bigger convenience stores and what have you. And the beauty of that is that the shopper can always choose to buy a local cheese brand. Part of my mission as well is to get shoppers to check the back of packs on the cheese brands. There are those out there that maybe are considered to be local, but when it comes to cheddar. But when you look at the back of pack and you examine the back of pack, you'll find that it is cheese sourced from all arts and parts of the world and packaged here. That is not something that the Dromona brand stands for. As I said earlier, it's right through from farm to fork, and we have full traceability, and it's only ever made here.
Sharon, there's a question on there actually from Keith. Are there different strengths of Dromona?
Yes, we produce a mild, medium, a mature, and an extra mature. Those are then processed into different size blocks from 200 grams to 350 gram to 600 gram, grated cheese and sliced cheese. And in recent times, we've also introduced a lactose-free, a naturally lactose-free Dromona line, which is available in block format and also sliced and grated format for retail.
Brilliant. Thanks, Sharon. It actually goes deliciously on that Irwin's fruit loaf. I've been nibbling
on that. I think, Sharon, that's a really heartfelt presentation that you've just done to us all. And please, cheese is cheese.
Absolutely.
I bet you ask everybody in this presentation, I bet you they've got block cheddar in their fridge right now.
Yeah.
All buy it, we all use it, and it's there for a purpose, and therefore, you know, everybody's going to always have artisan cheese in their fridge or handmade cheese in their fridge. So
and that's the flag that I want to fly for this brand, Tracy, because it is genuinely local. I don't know how many more times I can say it, but it is genuinely local, and it's a really, really good cheese. I mean, you guys were talking earlier about awards and so on and so forth. And I think, you know, I'm going to puff my chest up here and talk a little bit about the Dromona Awards, because our mature variant won Great Taste in 2019. And we've had fabulous results both with the Virtual Cheese Awards in 2021.
I was judging.
Yeah, our mild got a first for creamery mild cheddar. We got a first for our extra mature cheddar. We got a second for our mature, and those were both within the regional Irish cheese classes. And then in the International Cheese and Dairy Awards, again this year, we got both a first and a second from our medium, for our medium variant. And then on the back of that, we won the award for the overall best medium cheddar. And our mature cheddar also scooped second and third. So we're a local business and we are winning as a big cheese, for want of a better term, an everyday fridge staple. And we're winning on a national and international stage. And yeah, I think that's a lot to be proud of. And I think there's room for both in the market. I think there's room for both artisanal and bigger producers.
I don't know whether Johnny agrees with me, but when I had my delicatessen, we always had a block cheddar in the counter because it stopped people going off to the supermarket. They could do their whole shop with us. So a fantastic local milk, local, you know, you're supporting those farmers and those milk producers to have that product available there, ready, done, shopping out the door.
Yeah. And my goal in all of that is, I mean, if Johnny would like me to give him some for his cheese counter, I'd be very happy. Very happy.
Johnny, not mine.
I'm in Indie Fude on the Ormore Road very, very regularly. But no, all seriousness, you know, I have a job of work to do here, which is to really get those credentials across, because I think it's absolutely imperative and that will help me grow the brand at a local level. But to get, you know, the kudos of getting into delis and so on and so forth would be equally excellent. As with the opportunity to take this brand further afield, that would be my longer term goal.
Fantastic, Sharon. And yeah, I think it's you know what you have done, because you have a lot to be proud of, and it's a great story for Northern Ireland and that support of the farmers, which is loved and dear to all our hearts. And you know, continued success for what these guys are doing, and look forward to the rest of the journey and seeing you in the Ormore Road soon.
Thanks, Johnny.
Thanks, Sharon.
I think that's us. We've run over our time quite phenomenally, and thank you all for still being here. We're going to hang around. If anyone's got any questions, feel free to speak up, or if you just want to hang around for chat, likewise, please do. We'll be here for a little while longer. So floor's open. In the meantime, fantastic to see you all, and I wish you all a very Merry Christmas. Thanks again.